Okay.
We'll see how we go in an hour or so. See what gives. So I thought that I was thinking, should I like kill you with PowerPoint or should we have a conversation? And I thought maybe a conversation would be more fun, especially this time of day. Never do a PowerPoint before breakfast or after hours, I think. So I'm Australian originally. If you haven't worked that out. I live full-time here in New York, Manhattan, Gramsci, have for about 4 years. Love New York, spent a lot of time trying to get here. Was living sort of part-time for about 7 years, and I run a global research institute that has just a ton of research we're doing. Let me pause for a minute. I'll give you like a sort of 5-minute overview of sort of what we're doing, and then what I probably want to do is actually take your questions and have a dynamic where I sort of tell the story of the brain. We might do it in little colored squares. And I'll sort of tell you the story of the brain and leadership and sort of build it as we go. And I'm going to do it in a way I've never done before, so I'm creatively challenged and I have no idea how it's going to work. I thought that would be an appropriate thing here. So I thought, yeah, to tell you what I'm doing and then just really like you guys ask me questions and we'll sort of build a story together. So firstly, sort of, you know, a little bit of the arc. So about 17 years ago, I got really, really interested in this question of how do you help smart people grow faster? How do you help smart people learn faster, improve faster? And I can't really explain how or why, or it's just something I got kind of obsessed by. And I've been sort of immersed in that question all the way through and trying to develop like models and tools and insights and research, sort of how you do that. And the incarnation that's in now is I head up a research institute, NeuroLeadership Institute, and we have, it's about, all up, maybe about 60 full-time people and about another sort of 100 or so doing research and consulting and coaching and training things. And what we do is we tackle big questions that large companies haven't been able to solve, like, you know, how do you actually improve engagement? Or how do you actually give people feedback properly? Or how do you actually grow people faster? Or how do you do all these different things? And we basically put neuroscientists onto these questions and say, you know, we feel like if really smart people haven't been able to crack something, we think that usually it's because there's a misunderstanding of human nature at the heart of this. So, you know, like companies believe that people are motivated by money. Turns out that's not true. So let's educate, you know, them about what they are motivated by. Let's look at the brain to find out directly what actually motivates the brain. Let's not ask people. Let's actually find out from biology what goes on. So I digress. I do that in the evenings. The point is, we go after these big research projects. We have a team of neuroscientists on staff, and we work with the major labs around the country, and then we present these findings out in a journal roughly once a month, and then also at a very big conference each year. And if you can't get along to the summit, you can watch the whole thing for free. We probably have about 20,000 people watching this year, the event that we do. We do it at the Hudson Theatre this year. So anyway, we then commercialize it to actually pay the bills. We help really large companies like develop leaders better. And we do it in a few ways. We share the research out, and then we also do consulting with them. So we help them, you know, design better talent strategies, leadership development programs, that kind of stuff. And then we also do a little bit of giving them content in a scalable way to teach leaders about the brain. So we help leaders everywhere understand the brain so they can be more effective. So that's basically what we do. And what I've been thinking about for about the last 10 years is just how do you be an effective leader by understanding how the brain works. So I don't have to keep holding it, because things that you hold in mind take priority processing and keep distracting. I'm going to get this out. But I wrote this book, and so I'm going to talk a lot about, some of kind of what's in this. You can watch this whole book for free on YouTube, so you don't have to buy it at all. So don't worry about that. But but I'm going to sort of draw from that. And that book basically tells the story of like what it's like to do work and basically how to do it better if you're actually listening directly to the brain. So, you know, pretty much across all the spectrums of what you've got to do at work, both as a general employee and as a leader, we've been sort of digging in. What does the brain say about these things? All right, that's the preamble. What do you want to know? So that's, you know, literally that's, you know, what we do, and we publish, you know, tons and tons of research. And I guess I want to start actually with questions for you. So when I say leader, first of all, I'm talking about anyone who's trying to create change. right? So it could be someone who's trying to change a small process, a small scale, someone who's trying to change a community in any way, someone who's thinking about, you know, redesigning a process or you know, in any way. Not just formal leadership, it's really the art of facilitating, in particular, human change. So we really study how do you facilitate human change. And so I'd like to hear from maybe half a dozen of you, like what are the sort of, you know, like what comes up for you when you hear that? What are the sort of change projects that fascinate you? Just so we've got some content to sort of play with. What are some of the things you see yourself doing in the future as a result of, you know, your studies here? What kind of change kind of goals do you have? Does that make sense as a question? Great, some of you will answer it then, I hope. So let's hear it. By the way, speaking in public, speaking up in public is a sign of leadership. So. Who's got one? What sort of change journeys do you see yourself going on in the next decade? What are the things that you're passionate about improving in the world? Yeah.
Inspiring leaders to see that their decisions affect stakeholders, not just shareholders.
Hmm. Interesting. So getting people to see kind of the big picture and the whole system, all parts of the system. Great, that's good. What else? Yep.
My thesis is looking at nurses on the night shift and their eating habits because of your bodily functions suppress certain hormone productions and it creates different types of cravings and that lead to happen. So creating tools to better empower them to not fall into these bad habits.
Nurses and habits. Excellent. Should be nuns and habits. Nurses and habits, yes.
I'm curious. I'm working on a project that deals with social behavior change.
Yep.
So when a culture is behaving a certain way, it's very difficult for anybody to go against or even go out of that norm.
Yep.
So I'm really curious on that.
Culture change.
Yeah.
That's the kind of holy grail. How do you change a culture?
Mm-hmm.
Someone else? More? Yeah.
I'm interested, really interested on how creativity can be used in areas that it's not usually brought into and how that can change.
Okay.
People, the way people think or environments.
So like how to get other people more creative, do you mean?
And also to get people to understand that creativity is not necessarily just sitting and drawing or taking a photograph, but like how any kind of work that you do can be creative. It's more of like a mindset versus...
Yeah, so the creativity mindset.
Yeah.
And what's that creativity mindset? That's an interesting one. Someone else? Yeah.
I'm really intrigued by how to get people to use the human resources available to them better. So basically how to use things that people have already done or people that they can connect with better. For example, like with nonprofits or organizations or people trying to start a movement.
Right.
How do you build on what's already been done?
Like knowledge networks and
wheel. Yeah, basically improving knowledge networks.
Yeah. Good news is I can almost read my own writing. Okay. Someone else. One more. I feel like there's one more out there. Come on. Evolved. Yes.
I get large foundations and other people coming into communities to do work. How to help them learn how to listen and work with community rather than come in and impose models. So change the way they work with community.
Community change. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Interesting. All right, very good. So you know, some interesting themes there and you know what what's common there I think across the board is some kind of behavior change. You want to influence people to do things differently. Right? You want to influence nurses to do things differently. You want to influence a whole culture. You want to make people more creative. You want to, most of these, there's like a, people do it this way and I want them to do it this way. Right? Have you noticed that getting people to change the way they do things is one of the hardest things in existence, right? changing your own habits really hard. You know, getting others to change their habits is really hard. Getting a lot of people to change their habits is, it seems impossible. I'm sure you hear, school to learn, more and more about that. So I think that's the thread I'll start with, like what's involved in kind of changing habits more broadly. We'll sort of start with that and then we'll maybe get specific with this stuff. So let's jump into that. So I want to kick off with a bit of a sort of fundamental understanding of how the brain, how an individual brain processes the world moment to moment. Because when you're talking about systems, systems are made up of many individuals interacting, and companies and communities is really the sum of individual brains' reactions to things. Right? So let's start with just how people kind of interact with the world moment to moment. So one of the really interesting findings from neuroscience is there's a basic dualistic reaction to every bit of stimuli that hits your attention. Okay. So in plain English, everything that you see, feel, hear, taste, smell, touch, anything, your brain basically decides if it's one of two things, and that is if it's going to be good for you or bad for you. Right? So your brain decides with every single piece of sound, like every phoneme, every room, every chair, every person you sit next to, every pen you pick up, every word you write. It has this reaction, which is essentially, you can think of it as a toward response. See that'll work in the green, or an away response. The whole concept's not working now, because I'm going to change my concept. It's black on there. There we go. So a toward or away response, and I'll explain what that means. So your brain basically says something is like a potential reward for you. You should go toward. You should lean in. You should open up to it. You should think about it more, right? So you have a reaction. And by the way, your brain's doing this about 5 times every single second. So your brain's deciding if things are good or bad, threat or reward. I'll put threat there. I'll just put the model. Threats to stay away from, or rewards to go toward. Your brain's deciding about 5 times a second, right? And so it's basically saying, hey, I should do more of this. This is good for me. Or I should do less of this. This is dangerous for me. Now, at a basic neurological level, at the level of synapses, what's actually happening is it's called the behavioral activation system, which means that network was really fun. Let's do it again. So let's make more connections between all the synapses, right? So a single thought might be a billion synapses talking to each other. You know, it seems to somehow work. Let's make those synapses a bit stronger, right? And so then the behavioral inhibition system says, so that's the behavioral activation system, or the BAS system, BAS, this is BIS, BIS, says, you know what, that didn't work out so well. Let's go, let's do less of that. And so that network is going to become less wide. Yes? Question?
Yeah, I just had a question because you said that was more fun, let's do more of that. That was really fun, let's do more of that. But there are some things which are good for us, but they're not fun. Let's say when you train, so the muscles are in some kind of pain because they have more stress.
Yeah.
But it is good for you. So
yes.
How does the neurosystem react to that? Does it push it away, or does it
it's a great question. That's a great question. So if you're doing something that ultimately is good for you, but you're getting a negative reaction, an away response, which by the way is most things that are good for you, as far as I can tell, you what's happening in your brain is you've got this stay away response, and you've got to override it somehow.
But how do we know if it's the brain because it's something new or something challenging, or if it's really
we're going to need a couple of bottles of wine here, right? Until midnight. Okay, it's an excellent question. It's a very deep one to start with. What you do is you make these value judgments very quickly. So your brain's working so fast. I'm sure you've seen that. You've seen how fast you think, right? You speak at 800 words a minute. No, 100 words a minute. You're thinking of many thousands. So it's a huge amount of processing every second. So you're calculating, and you're doing it mostly based on prior information, prior knowledge, based on kind of probability. And so you'll get, what actually happens, it's a little complex, but what actually happens is you'll sort of pose a question, should I do this, shouldn't I do this? You'll pose a question to the brain, and you'll actually get dozens, if not hundreds, of potential answers, and they'll all argue with each other. And then one rises up to the top. So when you sort of have one idea, it's usually a lot of arguments have gone on beneath the surface. So you're talking about 100 billion neurons that each have about 10,000 connections, and each one of those 100 billion neurons is pinging 12 times a second at rest. without any thought going on. So there's a massive amount of processing going on. It's impossible to imagine. And so that's what's going on kind of underneath the surface. It's a little hard to explain, but what I can tell you is there's an automatic response, which is threat reward, and to a degree it can be overridden. Right? And we'll get to that bit. We'll absolutely dig into that bit quite a bit. So I'll just explain the sort of automatic response, then we'll dig into how you override it. So the automatic response is basically do more of this, activate it more, do less of this, inhibit it more. And they're literally very obvious brain networks. There's no such thing as a like brain region. I mean, there's a prefrontal and this stuff, but nothing happens in any one region, right? So it's like saying where does selling happen in New York? It's like, well, everywhere, you know, that chair and every part of the city, everything's selling, right? So there's no selling center, although, you know, Wall Street is a bit more selling, but selling is everywhere. It's like that with the brain. You know, where does water happen in New York? Well, it's everywhere, you know, everything's connected. So in the brain, nothing happens in any one place, but there are definitely networks that have a higher probability of activating, and they're usually a connection between many regions, and you can study those networks. And those networks often interact with other networks in really interesting ways. So for example, the network for thinking about, you know, yourself as a person, and when you start thinking about who you are, you know, that activates. When that activates, some other cool things deactivate, and vice versa. So this is sort of like seesaw effects between networks and networks that co-activate. That's the kind of stuff we study. So we're never studying, like, you know, what region of the brain does, you know, a decision happen in, because it's everywhere, right? We're studying the correlation of networks and things like that. It's very complex. But the point of all that is you have this positive reaction, and it's a network that is not that big. You have an away response. It's a much bigger network. Right? So when you sit down next to someone you've had lunch with before, you've had a good conversation, not your best friend, but you've had a good conversation, you get a nice reward response. Sit down next to someone that you had a mild disagreement with once, you'll get a really strong threat response. And it'll last for a long, long time. So bad is stronger than good, right? So they're very specific networks. There's a threat network in the brain. It's a much bigger network, much more robust. There's a reward network in the brain. You've probably heard of the amygdala. That's part of the threat network. It's only a small region. The threat network is bigger, but that kind of lights up according to how strong a threat is. So the amygdala, little almond-shaped area, that lights up according to how anxious you feel or how endangered. Feel. There's another part of the reward network called the ventral striatum, deep in the basal ganglia, even smaller, quite small. That also lights up according to the strength of how rewarded you are. So scientists have been able to study sort of, which color do people find more rewarding or more threatening, you know, what faces do people find more rewarding. So you've got these sort of gauges that scientists use. Anyway, I digress. So basically everything is threat or reward. Guess what happens if you can't work out if something is threat or reward? What's it classified as? Strong threat.
I say threat, yeah.
Yeah. So when you can't work out if something's good or bad for you, your brain classifies it as very bad. Classifies it as unusual and therefore deserving of attention. So if something doesn't make sense, right, your brain gives it priority processing. Something's not clear. And so uncertainty creates a threat response. In and of itself. Now, if you're in the change business, that's not good news. Right? Because the very thing that happens when you start talking about any kind of change is a whole lot of uncertainty, right? And the threat response, you know, tells people do less of this, stay away from it, be careful of it, all these kinds of things. So the basic output of threat and reward, I'll tell you, the basic output of threat and reward, I'm going to do something radical, and even though I get such a strong threat response, even thinking about it, I'm going to try and write with some chalk. I really do. It's such a strong dream. I'm going to go there in the spirit of, because whatever happens, I'm going to use it. Just hope there's no nails, Perception, so far so good. So perception goes down in a threat response, although it's kind of weird because it feels like it's going up. But what's happening is it goes up for a thin stream of data. So in a threat response, when you feel anxious, like let's say you're watching a TV show, and you're watching Breaking Bad. None of you would watch Breaking Bad. A scary scene comes on, and your heart rate goes up, and you feel really focused. But what's happening is you're focusing really deeply on the television, and someone could be like waving to you right next to the television, and you wouldn't see them. or all you see is like that bad thing that's about to happen, right? And so you sort of feel alert, but you're alert to a really small stream of data. And so perception goes down, cognition, which is working memory, goes down. Creativity has one of the biggest effects. So you get this big drop in creativity and also a big drop in collaboration. So P, C, C, C is, remember, perception, cognition, which is like working memory, doing math, creativity, which is divergent thinking, and collaboration. And creativity is the biggest effect. So even a mild threat response creates a really strong drop in these things, right? So essentially, people don't want to think about your ideas. They they don't want to be creative. They want to, you know, go back to what they know. They want to be safe, right? This is be safe. This is take risks, right? Creativity. There's an enormous increase in creativity between like here and here. Scientists have tested this. You can create a toward response and a threat response in very subtle ways. Literally, like ask someone to lean forward a tiny bit. It's a toward response. Lean back a tiny bit, it's a threat response. With a joystick, just push a joystick towards or away, create a threat and reward network in the brain. So very small things do this. And a tiny threat reward response, you don't even feel, it's like a 50% difference in creativity in terms of the ability for people to solve problems, creative kind of stuff. So it matters a lot if you try and get people to think differently in this threat reward system. So anyway, this is the basis of like our reactions to things. So you're pitching your nurse strategy, right? You don't want a threat response. You want a reward response, right? You're pitching your community change strategy. You want a reward response. Right? You're pitching your whatever strategy. So you want to be thinking, how do I get a reward response, right? That's the first idea, and I want to pause there and give you a chance to just digest this. One thing I know about the brain is it kind of likes listening sometimes, but it also really likes talking. And so I just want to find a partner, no more than three people, two or three people, and just digest this. Everything I've said so far, just make sense of it, talk about it, make fun of me, whatever you like. But just talk about this in terms of what it's explaining, what it's reminding you of. I'm sure you know this in different ways. What's it reminding you of or explaining? Give you about 3 or 4 minutes, then we'll come back, see if you have any questions, and we'll build the next chapter. Go. In a minute, we'll get into, so what do you do with this and you know, all that. But any questions so far? Yeah.
Might be forward, so put it on the side if it is. I mean, forward in time, not inappropriate. So, so we were talking about, Emily just had to get up, but she's a designer, and she said, you know, she gets nervous when she first gets a creative brief about the unknown. Like, she doesn't know what she's going to produce yet, but that's when she's most creative, and that she likes that. And our question was kind of, do creative people tend to have a certain response to the threat side? Like, are they better at overcoming it, or is someone better, you know, which comes first? Or are they, you know, if somebody is good at dealing with the unknown, does that kind of predetermine that they'll be more?
It's a great question. So let's talk for 5 minutes about the creative process and the threat response. I think it's a great place to diverge from it. So, firstly, like, you know, getting a creative brief is terrifying, because you have no idea what you're going to do, right? And there's definitely really strong variation in how people deal with that. I'm going to do it again. See if you guys okay this time. So you've got an inverted U of arousal. If this is performance, and this is arousal, which is really the threat response, but it's a bit more complex than that. But So you've got like this sort of peak area of performance. You've probably seen this before. We've known it since 1908, but it's like it correlates with activation of basically the levels of dopamine and norepinephrine. So dopamine is interest and norepinephrine is alertness. It's like brain adrenaline, right? So it correlates with it, and they've done this at a bunch of places. So this art correlates. We've got to have lots of interest and lots of alertness. Right? And alertness is like alert to danger, right? Adrenaline is something could go wrong, right? And so it's sort of complicated, but there are some people where they'll get to this peak of performance at pretty low levels of arousal, but high levels of arousal they'll sort of fall apart, right? So some people, if it's too much arousal, they'll fall apart easy. Other people, they need a lot of arousal to even get to the peak performance. So it's sort of moved over here. So some people it's here and some people it's here. And generally creative people actually like quite a lot of alertness, quite a lot of uncertainty, and they're comfortable with it. They also, like, if you interview them behaviorally, a lot of creative people take all sorts of risks in terms of they like to feel a little on the edge. They like to do things that are novel. Novelty creates alertness and dopamine, actually. So they experience a lot of novelty. They don't live in the same place, do the same things, go to the same school, right? So they're people that thrive on sort of higher levels of arousal, of interest and alertness, right? I'm sure if we interviewed all of you, you've probably done all sorts of really curious, interesting things that were a bit scary at the time, but, you know, were great for you, right? You know what I'm talking about? So, and then there are other people who really like a lot of certainty. So there is a tendency, it's an individual tendency to be comfortable with uncertainty. And people study that. There's actually a threshold, and people have compared whether Republicans or Democrats have variation in that. And yes, it's true, Republicans tend to like a lot more certainty, and Democrats are much more comfortable with uncertainty. And that, of course, research is very controversial, but pretty solid. So there's definitely a threshold. Look, all that is to say that, yeah, people are different at their levels of certainty. Now, why that matters for creativity is a little bit more complex, but basically, I keep feeling like your drink's going to spill, by the way. It's just like a tiny alert in the corner of my eye. Just a tiny little, my perception.
Stage.
Is,
yeah. I'm keeping it by this toes.
My perception is wide, I just this tiny alert signal from down here. So the reason that matters is creativity, as well as like, well, the reason it matters is like this. This is your prefrontal cortex here. This is your basically this region here, right? It's about this thick, about 6 business cards thick. It's sort of here to here. It's very small. It ties easily. And this is what you use if you're trying to be logical, if you're not trying to be creative, right? So if you're trying to do math, you're trying to be logical, and a number of other things, you activate this region. It's called the prefrontal cortex, or PFC for short, right? So this little tiny region here, this is what you use if I say, let's do some math, let's add up 56 and 79, or let's think about this reason versus this reason. You know, when you're consciously logical, you activate this region. It has a whole bunch of limitations. But when you can't find an answer in your memory, right, you need to solve a problem in an unexpected way. You try to solve a problem, you try to do math, there's no answer. You can't tap into that region anymore. You've got to find the answer in deeper regions of the brain. And what we know from studies of insight, and there's been about a decade of neuroscientists studying people having insights, literally generating insights with people in the scanner. What we know is that when you have an insight, you're basically connecting distant regions of the brain in ways. And they're very subtle electrical signals that connect. So in order to have these creative breakthroughs, you've got to be able to notice quiet signals in the brain. You've got to be able to connect what are called, weak activations. So you've got this tiny, I'll give you an example, you've got this tiny memory, you're trying to solve a problem. It got cool in here, didn't it? So you're trying to solve this problem of, a cup holder in this room, we'll go with that. And you try and remember, something that you saw somewhere, but you can't quite remember. And you're trying to connect that with other memories of materials you've used, and all this stuff is sort of hard to recall. So what happens is people who are able to keep their brain quiet, like literally not a lot of electrical noise, they're able to make these weak connections better. And so this is why you have these breakthrough ideas when you first wake up in the morning. You see that? Or when you're in the shower, or when you're exercising, or when you're doing anything that makes your brain quieter, you'll have these breakthrough ideas. And what's happening is that you're actually reducing the ambient noise level of your brain, and so these connections can actually come through. They've probably been trying to come through for a while. So you have these moments of insight, these aha moments, because your brain's quiet. And so creative people can deal with a whole lot of uncertainty and still quiet their brain, because generally they're okay with uncertainty. And they've often practiced being okay with uncertainty, this kind of stuff too. So it's a really, it's an interesting area. It's actually one of the first things I studied. I'll send to Shaw some of the papers. I wrote one called The Aha Moment, which summarizes everything I said. And it's sort of written in everyday terms, but it looks at the 4 conditions that your brain needs to maximize the moment of insight. And one of them is basic quiet, so your brain is fairly quiet. One of them is you're able to look inside yourself, like look into your thinking, like track back without, being worried about crashing your bike or something. So you're able to look inside your thinking. The third is that you're slightly positive, so you're not too negative, you're slightly in a towards state. And the fourth is you're not actively working consciously on the problem. You might be working around it, but you're not like using prefrontal. And we see when you have those four conditions, you have dramatically more insights. What's that?
You'll send it to us?
I will send it to you, yeah. Oh, you can also find it online. It's called How to Have More Insights. It's on Psychology Today. Just look up David Rock, How to Have More Insights. Or just David Rock Insights. So I blog at a ton of places, but it's at Psychology Today, and you'll see it there. That's even faster. I'll go with a really complicated name. Anyway, that's one question. Other questions? What we covered so far? Yes.
One of the things we were talking about is how sometimes you can sort of start tricking your brain, so like with exercising, which you know is good for you, but you don't necessarily like, how you can start to trick yourself by thinking, oh, like I'm having so much fun, and smiling, and is that really, does that really help?
It can do, if you believe it. Let's talk about that. So how do you trick your brain? And it relates back to a question that sort of came up earlier. It's like, how do you override this automatic process? Let's answer that question. I think that'd be fun. So what's happening is you get these automatic processes. They occur, and usually you consciously notice them quite a bit after they've started to occur, right? So you're watching a scary TV show, and you know something bad happens, your heart rate's gone up, and you only notice yourself feeling uncomfortable at best, like a third of a second later, mostly more like many seconds later, you start to notice it. So you have automatic reactions to the world, right? And then you can intervene. So what happens with a threat response is it actually pulls away resources from the prefrontal. Let me get a little more complex with this. If this is reward and this is threat and this is time and seconds, this is reward. So if you have like a reward response, let's say you run into a friend, you know, over a few seconds, it's positive, it goes down. If you run into someone you had an argument with, in less than a second, it's gone a long way down, it's gonna stay there for a long time, right? So an hour later, you might still be obsessing about that person. So the threat response comes on faster, lasts longer, right, than the reward response. So a little bit of threat can really have an impact. So a little bit of threat might have the same result as like a lot of reward. So either a little bit of threat or a lot of reward pulls away a significant amount of oxygen and glucose from prefrontal function, right? So they're inversely related. The complexity of that is just that you need quite a lot of reward to do the same thing. Anyone play poker? Willing to own up to it? Anyone play poker? Have you noticed how much money you can lose on two aces, right, on the flop? Because you get really excited you're going to win, and you completely forget that someone could beat you with three twos. You actually feel the excitement, and your heart's racing, just like a threat response. And so this overexcitement makes you make all sorts of cognitive errors as well. You know what I'm talking about? And so you've got to regulate your emotions back to more neutral, because it's really weird how it happens, even if you're playing for matchsticks. But you've got too strong a reward that's also pulling away resources from prefrontal, right? So, mild to moderate threat, very strong reward will both do that, okay? Now, the reason I'm telling you this is that I made some space. Logical is one thing that you do. The other thing that the prefrontal does, as well as like cognition, is it also works out about, it's basically your people network, like reading people. So it's your, we'll just put reading people. Like, why is someone doing something? So reading people's intentions, right, accurately.
Prefrontal,
yeah. So it's actually, the prefrontal's got all these subregions. It's technically medial prefrontal, M-E-D-I-A-L, which is like the middle. It's like, literally like where you think the third eye might be, right? So medial prefrontal is the social network in the brain, not where Facebook links in, maybe one day. But it's where you read people and their intentions and their goals, try to understand them. And by the way, where you also read yourself, where you try to like think about yourself. So when you think about yourself and what you want to do, or think about other people and what they want to do, you activate this medial network. So what happens is that goes down. And another thing that's really bad is this is also where your impulse control lives. So the prefrontal is also how you control impulses. And any kind of impulse. So if there's a break, as in stopping, right? There's a break in the brain. It's basically here and here. It's called the ventrolateral prefrontal cortex, and it's a break for stopping yourself doing, you know, anything or feeling anything or saying anything or moving or anything. And it's actually the same braking system that you use for all types of braking, right? So you've got lots and lots of accelerators, one brake. And this brake happens to be built inside the prefrontal. This is the medial, this is the lateral prefrontal, sort of here and here, right? So you've got this brake. Now this, you're starting to see like where the problem comes in here. So you go into a situation and you get a little bit of a threat response. You stop being logical, you stop reading people well, and you can't control your impulses. And this happens at pretty low levels. So the way I talk to my kids about this, I have 11 and 7 year old girls. The way I talk to them is like your ability to stop yourself doing something you ultimately know you shouldn't do, is a bit like using your foot as a brake on a motorcycle. Right? It's only going to work either before you start moving or just as you start moving. But once you're going even a little bit, your foot's going to be no use at all. Right? So you've got to use your brake before you move, right? Or just as you start to move, it's useful. But basically, because of this factor, a second into a threat response, the oxygen and glucose has gone out of the very region that is necessary to put the brakes on. Right? And it's very hard to stop yourself doing things you shouldn't do. And all kinds of impulses. So now let's go to the flip side of that and answer your actual question. I needed to give that sort of foundation. So what we know is there's something that you can do that turns on this braking system really well. And it turns this braking system on whether you know about the science or not. It just does it automatically. And one of those things is basically changing your interpretation of situations. Right? So you look at a photograph of someone crying outside a church, and your automatic reaction is to feel like it was a funeral, and you decide, you know what, maybe it was a wedding. Maybe they're tears of joy. And as you change your interpretation, your actual threat reward system changes, and all your biochemistry changes. All this stuff changes from altering your perception of the event, right? Or you're looking at someone in a hospital bed, they look really sick, your automatic reactions get a bit of a threat response, they look like you're in danger. And then someone says to you, you know what, they're actually twice as good as they were like a few days ago, and they're really on the mend, they're so much better. And you go, okay, you're in a reward response, right? So you're changing your interpretation of events, right? Now this is technically called reappraisal. It's technically called reappraisal. You can think of it as recontextualizing or reframing, or it's got many different words in psychology and throughout history. But what's happening is you're actually taking something that you saw as bad and turning it into something you see as good. You know, you are looking on the bright side, right? And what we know is that when you do that, you switch on the brain's braking system automatically, and you switch down the emotions, the negative emotions. But you can do it two ways. You can also look at something that's slightly bad and decide it's really bad. And you can switch down the positive emotions and switch up the negative emotions, which doesn't end well. And that's what happens to people who suffer depression a lot. They keep looking on the downside, and they go into a bigger spiral. Question?
I'm curious about what you said. It happens in an instance of time. And what I can see from this map is that in a small time, threat can be more fast.
Yes.
So could this be true that we are more tend to get things in the wrong way?
Yes, and we get them in the wrong way quickly. And it's hard to come back.
Yes.
Yes. And if you upset someone that's a stakeholder in a project you're in, and you upset them, you're sort of done. You know, it burns that memory and that you're a danger to them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it happens quickly. Yeah.
So can you recontextualize old memory? That has
to be Yeah. You can recontextualize anything. And this area has been studied a lot. It's called reappraisal. It's got to feel real to you. It's got to be believable to you. But you basically make this value judgment about everything: is it good or bad? Unconsciously, and it turns out you can override it and decide, you know what? Actually, maybe that's good. Now, I'm going to tell you a few kind of really deep things here that philosophically, challenging. I will agree. They're philosophically challenging, but here's what the research says. So scientists have devoted their lives to this whole concept. There's a whole bunch of scientists who've devoted their whole careers to this area. One of them's by the name of James Gross, G-R-O-S-S, is at Stanford. He's really the founding father of emotional regulation research. He's done some really, really cool studies. And one of the things he did was he basically looked at the people who are able to reappraise well versus people who are not able to reappraise well when emotions come along. And he found that on 12 different axes, they're just better off in every single way. Like, they're just better off in every way if you're able to reappraise. And what we see from emotional regulation literature is that reappraisal is the only real tool that works once an emotion kicks in. Like, before an emotion kicks in, you can divert your attention, you can decide to, you know, look at your phone instead, you can change strategies, all sorts of things you can do before an emotion kicks in. But once an emotion kicks in, suppression makes emotions worse. So, you know, trying not to feel it tends to actually make the limbic system even worse. Impacts memory, you have a secondhand smoke effect, other people become uncomfortable as well. So suppressing emotions doesn't work. So for strong emotions, reappraisal is all you've got. There really is nothing else that comes, you know, anywhere near to it. And so the question often becomes, you know, yep, this could be good, this could be bad, but what's the most adaptive way to see this? What's the most adaptive way to see the situation? Right? How should I see the situation so it's going to help me with my overall goals? So yeah, maybe this person was mean to me, but maybe from what that crazy Australian guy said, deciding he was mean to me was one of 12 possible interpretations, all arguing with each other, and one just landed. And maybe there's just one possible interpretation. Maybe he was having a hard day. Maybe he didn't get much sleep. Maybe he's feeling really stressed. Maybe it wasn't anything to do with me and I reminded him of someone else, right? And so maybe I'm going to see how I can be really helpful here instead. And you reappraise. Now, what we know, if you're a change agent in any way, you're going into the fire. You're the personal trainer of human beings. You're taking pain, you know, all the time. As a change agent, as someone who's a leader who wants to create change in the world, you're steering into the pain. You're saying, I'm going to change people and I'm going to get a whole lot of pain. So you really need reappraisal as a tool. It's really the best tool that there is. A tool on the way to reappraisal that's pretty good is called labeling, which is just summarizing your emotional state, identifying your emotional state. But reappraisal is really the power tool. So the question becomes, you know, I could feel this, I could feel that. What's the adaptive response I should have to the situation? What's the most adaptive response I should have to the situation, right? And, what you want to do as a change agent is you want to shake people's heads and reappraise for them. You want to say, no, see it like this, right? You see that coming? You can't really do that. You can create the space for people to reappraise for themselves, but you can't reappraise for them. You can only reappraise yourself. It's not funny. All right, so, questions. Where else would you like to go? Change. I should come back to the change question. How do you actually create change? I've got a big idea I should get to. Yes?
I guess, sorry, I just want clarification around. When you talk about reappraisal, like, what gives you the ability to sort of move beyond that automated response?
What gives you the ability to move beyond the automated response?
To the reappraisal.
Yeah. So there's a mechanism that's already built in that we hijack, right? So there's a mechanism that's already there, and it's a mechanism to basically update your interpretation, right? So if I'm at the airport, like at JFK, sometimes it's gates a long way down, sometimes if I'm going on a hop or I want to sleep, I want to get some food before, and I can't see the gate. It's, you know, the flight's going in 30 minutes. And I look at the food line, and the line's long, and I'm going, oh, should I? And I get in the line, and I start, you know, the line, and my heart starts racing. Am I going to miss the flight? Because, you know, I'm getting a threat response. And I don't have any data, and then I finally get the food, my heart's really racing, and I, you know, run down towards there, and then suddenly I see there's a long line, right? And without, I don't need to do any conscious reappraising. The instant I see the long line, I settle down. So the world was updated. The data was updated. Right? There was a refresh of my, my brain automatically reappraised the potential danger in this situation. And your brain does that all the time. It automatically reappraises danger or reward. And it just so happens that you can consciously do that.
Right. So I guess I meant like in cases where, for example, you were misinterpreting the scenario outside of your brain, to then
like remind yourself, oh, this is not actually how it looks, and having those other tools to say,
yeah,
I can rephrase it and reinterpret.
Well, I think it helps to begin with realizing that the way you see the world is just like a mess. I don't mean you personally, but the way you see the world is so random, and just one possible way to see it, you know, and it's so emergent out of, you know, billions of points of data, and it's so random, you know, and the more you understand about the brain, the more you just start saying to yourself, that's just my brain, you know, it might not be real, and so I think it's that sort of loosening up of, you know, that's just one interpretation that, you know, comes to me. Now, if you travel a lot, you'll be able to do that more because you've lived in other worlds and other cultures and you've seen the world through other contexts, right? You know that feeling like it's really interesting, you know, going to a completely other culture and you go, gosh, seeing the world in this whole different way. So people who, you know, live in other cultures are, you know, quite good at reappraisal because they've had practice that sort of, you know, my way was just my way. Actually, there might be a whole different way of eating food. Never thought of that. I should eat food with my hands. Oh, maybe I should eat food with chopsticks. Maybe I should eat food with who knows what, right? It's like, oh, I always thought there was one way to eat food. And so you become more flexible as a thinker, you know, when you travel, for example. And that's what you have to do. You have to become flexible as a thinker and going, yeah, that's just the way I see it now. Then you get into this world around bias and you discover your brain has these crazy biases. That's a conversation for another time. So you just sort of loosen up and go, that's just one way. And the question becomes, what's the most adaptive way to see this? But you have to believe it. Question? Yes?
Well, I just want to add, we talk a lot about empathy
yeah.
and how we use that as a tool for research and stuff in our project. And this just reminds me a lot of that sort of kind of like having empathy for yourself.
It's nice.
Okay.
That is nice, yeah. It's true. Having a bit of empathy for yourself and that, you know, yeah, that's a good idea, but it's kind of a crazy idea. It could be other ideas, and not being hard on yourself about it as well. Yeah.
I want to hear more about the fact that you have to believe it, because because the fact that I thought something out of 12 possibilities is because that's what I believe. And
it's random.
Something that I believe, otherwise it's not that easy.
Well, it's random. You might believe something different if while you were standing at the deli getting lunch, you saw a newspaper headline that said something different.
Like it's just like, it's very random.
Okay, so. Yeah.
It's dark and quiet inside your brain. It's dark and quiet inside your brain. It's dark and quiet inside your brain. And if you have no light, like if you don't have, if you're blind, or dumb. If you're blind and then you suddenly start seeing at 20, you can't see. Because like you suddenly get eyesight, you actually still can't see. Because what happens is your brain actually needs to be trained and build these complex maps of what everything actually means inside your brain so that the electrical activity turns into reality. Because it's dark in there. And what you see right now is just the result of, you know, billions of neurons deciding that that's a chair and that's a person and that's, I think, a laptop or something, or an iPad, there you go. And like, you know, 5 years ago that wasn't an iPad, it's something else. And it could be so these interpretations argue with each other, and the one that just makes the most sense rises to the top. But if you look at just how we process light and sound, you'll see that the meanings we add to things are really quite just sort of emergent out of just past patterns. And those past patterns are laid down randomly. So, yeah. That's a deep one. Where's that bottle of wine? All right, I want to give you one more big piece. I say one more question. I want to give you a really big piece and bring this back to change and say, how do we actually use this to create change better? Because that's probably an important thing to answer. Yeah.
So you were saying the threat response part of the brain is larger than the reward response
yeah.
part?
Network.
Is there a way to, or the network, is, yeah. there, a, is there a way to increase the size of the reward response?
Increase the size of the reward network. I mean, you can. There's also it's a more subtle way to answer that, is that we have a bias. So you don't necessarily increase the size of any region. Well, you can to a degree, but you wouldn't increase the size of your reward network, but you could increase the
amount of reward you get in certain experiences. So you can increase the activation of your reward system in certain in situations. So one of the ways to do that is you bias yourself overall a little bit more to the positive, right?
Yeah.
So if you're an airline pilot, right, I don't want you to be positively biased, right? I want you to be thinking about all the things that could go wrong, and I want you to be really, you know, vigilant, right, to every little detail. This over this side is detailed, over this side is more abstract, right? So if you're an airline pilot, I really want you to be, you know, this side. But if you're an artist, I want you to be over this side, right? I want you to be open to all possibilities. You know, I don't want a pilot open to all possibilities. I want them like, you know, something else. So,
yeah, that's awesome.
So or they end up falling asleep on a flight to Boston. You hear about that one? Like, you know, so it's a true story. So the so what you can do is you can positively bias yourself more just by, you know, spending attention more on positive things. So, you know, if you put the television on, you'll negatively bias yourself quite a bit. Most things on the television are, you know, designed to make you focus in on the screen. The easiest way to do that is with threat. So mostly, every time you watch TV, your heart rate goes up, your cortisol goes up, your immune function goes down, and you die younger. Because you're... Just throw that one in there. They've actually worked out the formula for every like day of TV watching. Now, but the reason for it is just the threat response. I mean, people in a threat response die younger. Right? In a threat response, your cortisol production goes up, which is the threat response. Your immune function goes down. You heal slower. You get sicker, and your overall production of, you know, healing processes is worse here than here. So yeah, there's all sorts of good reasons to be more positive biased, unless you're an airline pilot. Or accountant. So what you can do is experience positive thoughts. It's really easy to test someone's positive negative bias. You literally just flash up positive words and negative words and see how quickly they process them. So if you're positive bias, when you flash up positive words, you literally read them faster. Like your eyes track them faster, they occur, you get the insight in your brain faster. If you're negative bias, the negative words jump out faster and faster. So you can see people's bias and you can shift it a little bit just by literally focusing on more positive things. That's one of the few things that some of the brain training games out there do a little bit. They can shift your bias a little bit, some of that stuff. I have no financial interest in any of it. But that's a fun thing. So let me bring this around to something I want to sort of close with, because this is good. I want to give you a piece of language that I developed that kind of summarizes a world of fun. So. One of the things that I started to do in 2003, when I first started sort of really getting serious about brain research, is I basically went and visited lots of neuroscientists who seemed to be, you know, writing interesting things. You know, I'd read about them and I'd go and visit them, and I kept hearing this really interesting story emerging out of these labs at NYU and UCLA and Columbia, and basically people were studying threat and reward and. Finding that all these weird things were creating threat and reward. Now, to get a little bit more complex, there's actually not one threat system, there's a number of threat systems, right? It's not one reward system, there's a number of them. But there's one in particular which you think of as the primary threat system, and it's also known as the pain network. So it's primary in that it's the strongest threat system, and when you experience pain, you know, you can't really focus much at all, right? If you're experiencing pain, it's really hard to be logical, to control impulses, all this stuff. So the pain network in the brain switches on in certain situations. And basically, scientists were finding all these weird and quirky ways where this primary pain and pleasure system, you know, it's also the primary reward is the pleasure system, where these things were switching on. And it turns out that the brain feels very intensely about social situations. There was a whole bunch of things that were switching on this network. And like, for example, someone like being treated unfairly in an exercise, even just in a tiny way, would activate a strong pain response. Or someone being treated fairly would activate a reward response. And you'd get a stronger reward as if you were giving them money or chocolate, like something that people, you know, said they really, really liked. Just treating them slightly fairly would activate a strong reward response, right? Or just, you know, seeing a friend would activate this reward response. Or having someone, you know, a friend hold your hand while you put, you know, your hand in an ice bucket, you could hold it in for longer somehow. And you'd see a reward. It's not the ice bucket challenge, but it predated that. But so there's all these quirky things. And what they found was that the brain cares massively about social threats and rewards.
And it's literally true to say that the strongest threats and rewards are social. And this is a clue to how to be a great change agent. And so what I did was I summarized all these different studies to say what are the things that the brain cares most about. I'll see if I've got some cards, enough cards here to do it. I'll see if I do some cards. I'm just going to warn you, they might be different colors and it might not make much sense, but we'll see how we go. We need five. One, two, three, four. Oops, drop one. There we go. That'll do. All right. So there's these five situations that the brain cares a lot about. Three, four. Don't make it mean anything that those ones are smaller. So the first one is status. So there are a whole lot of processes that go on, unconscious to you, that basically determine your status and other people's status, right? And the difference between the two, every person that you meet. You'll often do it based on sort of obvious things, like someone who's taller than you, you'll decide their higher status. But someone who seems smarter than you, you'll decide their higher status. Someone who seems more attractive than you, or better dressed than you, whatever, funnier than you, it's many axes. But basically, we decide who's higher or lower status. Right? Now, when you feel like you're higher status, you get a nice little reward. But when you feel like they're higher status, the other person, remember this thing here, you get a pretty strong threat response. Right? So when you feel like someone is telling you that your great strategy for maintaining your weight as a nurse is wrong, right? You're probably going to argue with them because it makes you look bad and them look good. When someone tells you your strategy for improving the water distribution in this community is wrong, you're going to probably fight them as if your life depended on it. And the reason for that is your brain detects a status threat as a mortal threat. So when you feel like someone's attacking your status, your brain reacts as if someone's threatening your life. And it is actually pretty true. The higher status you live longer, lower status you die younger. It's controlling for income and education. There's an entire book on that. Literally higher status lives longer. Not about money or socioeconomic status, it's sociometric status, status in the community that you're in. You'd be quite poor but actually live longer than anyone else if you're high status in that community. Sociometric, not socioeconomic. So higher status does equal living longer and lower status does equal dying younger, literally. So we protect our status any way we possibly can. So you can see that going in and trying to change anyone or anything can create all these status threats. And you will fight against that. So that's one of the five domains that we're constantly managing all the time, right? The second one is certainty. Certainty is your ability to predict the future, understand what's happening, know where things are going, be able to read a situation. And a little bit of uncertainty activates a lot of threat response. If you don't know if you're meeting a friend or not, after the session, it's a maybe, maybe not, you don't know how to contact them. That one thing will come up in your mind probably 10 or 20 times over and over. You'll keep processing it until it's solved. Right? That's a sign of a threat response. Something that keeps coming up is a sign of a threat response. If you don't know when I'm ever going to end tonight, you'll have that thought coming up over and over and over, probably in about 15 minutes. So certainty goes up or down in every interaction. Now, you go and pitch your idea to this community, and you're probably going to reduce certainty. They're going to feel more and more uncertain. So now you've got a threat response. The third one is autonomy. It's an interesting one, autonomy. We have this weird mechanism where if we feel like we're able to make choices, if we feel like we are in control, then it's a reward. And if we feel like other people are in control of us, it's a threat. Okay. So autonomy is a feeling of control, feeling that you have choice. And with all of these, a little positive or a little negative actually matters a lot, like a tiny difference, right? So if you're trying to drive a culture change in a group of people, you're trying to drive a culture change, and you come in and tell them all the things they have to do, you're reducing their autonomy. But if you kind of map out two possible futures and in an unattached way say to them, would you like to brainstorm these two futures and sort of make your own mind up about this, you might raise autonomy. You help them see options. Right? And seeing options we didn't know we had raises autonomy. Seeing options raises autonomy. So autonomy is a wonderful thing to raise and a bad thing to drop because it creates a threat response. Now, relatedness is a big one on a small piece of something.
but I'm going to spend a little longer on it. It's a really quirky, weird decision. I'm going to come back to the empathy question from before. Relatedness is what it says. Can't you read that? It's really obvious. Relatedness. So your brain classifies every single person as in-group or out-group. So your brain decides each person if they're in your in-group or out-group. So most of you will have in-group with most of each other here because you've had shared experiences, right? And you've probably got shared goals. Shared goals is in-group. So we basically classify, it's an evolutionary adaptation, and we classify people as sort of, you know, on our team, going to be helpful to us, or basically dangerous to us. You know, because we lived at times in war and famine, small groups of people, anyone who was a stranger was probably going to kill you. Or you know, steal your resources or both. So we trust the people that we feel like we've got common goals with, and anyone else we don't. Now here's how it plays out in the brain. When you feel like someone has got shared goals with you, so if you feel like someone's heading in the same direction, when they speak to you, your brain processes anything they say, unless it's horrible and a threat, your brain processes anything they say using the same brain network as thinking your own thoughts. I can repeat that. When you process information from someone, this is independent of what they say, you process information from someone who you feel you have shared goals with, so you're both like trying to achieve the same kind of thing. They can't be lofty goals, they don't have to be immediate, but they have to be things you actually want to get done together. So you're processing information from someone that has shared goals with you. When they speak to you, your brain processes what they say using the same brain network as thinking your own thoughts.
So you can manipulate.
That's exactly how you can manipulate.
You just did the way negative side of it.
We have to see both.
That's exactly what salespeople do all the time, is they try to, like, first of all, find out what your goals are and try to make you feel like you share their goals so that you'll have what's called rapport, you know, all this stuff. My first reaction when you said empathy before was, oh, I hate it when people try to pretend that they have empathy with me. Like, it really upsets me because I know it's a manipulation, right? They, and we can all sense that stuff, right? But when we have a shared goal with someone, we treat them as an extension of us and we let them into our head. And we actually start having mental images that we wouldn't have if they were an out-group member, if we didn't have shared goals. So shared goals means we process, like, visually as well. We see what people are saying much, much more. If someone has competing goals with you, not just not shared goals, but competing goals with you, right, you don't see what they're saying. You almost never picture. You don't let them in your head, do you? Someone with competing goals, you're not going to literally create visual images of anything they say. You're going to shut them out. And you end up using a completely different brain network to process anything they say. So just based on shared goals or competing goals, right? So in-group or out-group. So it gets worse. So perception is massively impacted. But the second thing is empathy, going to empathy. You basically don't have empathy with people who are in your out-group. Your brain, you won't feel this way, and you know, no matter how much we question you, you'll say that you don't feel any different, but you won't feel empathy with people who are in your out-group. You might feel like you do, but your brain doesn't treat them as if, you know, in the same way at all. And I'm going to go there. It's a little controversial. I'm going to go there. So, you know, one of the studies they've done is they've got, like, Asian and Caucasian face. They've done it with, you know, black and white, all sorts of races, different races. But basically you'll show a Caucasian face and you'll have a face. This is people in the scanner. So you have a Caucasian person looking at a Caucasian face that's either getting a needle in the cheek or a cotton bud. And the Caucasian person looking at the Caucasian face getting a needle, their brain center lights up that feels pain. So you actually feel pain, but you don't feel any different, but your brain actually lights up as if you were experiencing the pain themselves. So you don't feel physical pain, but your brain literally, like, your brain's pain center lights up that's as good as feeling pain. Now, if you're not a Caucasian person, that doesn't happen. There's just no activation of the pain center, right? And the same the other way. So if, you know, a Caucasian person is looking at an Asian person having a needle, there's no activation of the pain center. So someone who's just a different race to you, doesn't matter what the race is, it's nothing to do with any particular race, someone who's a different race to you, your brain treats them as if they don't have feelings, and you don't automatically have that mirroring. You've probably heard of mirror neurons. You don't have that mirroring automatically that's necessary to build
kind of emotional responses on. And so I told you it gets worse. And then it gets even worse or better, depending on your perspective, we'll rephrase it, which is that motivation. So if you're you know, working with an out-group member, you get rewarded when they... So you're working with an out-group member with different goals, you're rewarded when they fail and threatened when they win. Right? You're working with an in-group member, you're rewarded, obviously, when they win, you're threatened when they fail. So people become an extension of you. In a similar way, when in studies of people, you know, sweeping something, the broom becomes an extension of the body in the brain. It literally like becomes part of the body after a little bit. The same way in-group members become like an extension of you, and you know, you feel their feelings and their goals become your goals and this kind of stuff. So clearly you need in-group if you try to like work with people, right? But you come along with your great idea for a change project and they decide you've got competing goals and now there's no conversation. Yeah.
Is it possible, let's say one person who was in outlook before for you, but like, is it possible to switch that?
Yeah, the good news is it's extremely malleable.
Okay.
So all of that is overridden by the fact that you can make this extremely malleable. Particularly, shared experiences does it a little bit, shared goals does it a lot. So you can have someone who, you know, had nothing in common with whatsoever. They can be 50 years older than you, completely different race, completely, you know, different gender, different body weight, different everything. And you really outgroup, and then you discover, you find yourself working on a shared goal with them, you'll treat them completely as in-group. And the shared goal doesn't have to be lofty. It can be that we're going to clean up the kitchen together. That's the good news. So the bad news is without shared goals, we treat people badly. But it's pretty easy to create shared goals. Unless people feel manipulated. There's one more. Fairness. Fairness is, as it sounds, it's a sense of equity, it's a sense of being treated fairly. Other people, it says fairness. 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 So fairness. So a little bit of fairness, unfairness is a threat, the other is a reward, right? So here's an easy way to remember it. It's S-C-A-R-F, which spells scarf. Scarf. Say scarf, that's right, but scarf. And this is a framework that looks at like all the different possible reactions to anything you're doing anytime with others, right? So you want to put in place a system for nurses to be more healthy. How's that going to impact their status, their sense of certainty, their autonomy, their related status? And how can you minimize the threats and work out ways that maybe one or two of these can actually go up? Maybe they can look good out of this because it looks like their idea. Or maybe they can feel like they've suddenly all these new choices have opened up they didn't know they had, right? So how can you put some of these in the positive? But the golden rule with threats is minimize them first, like avoid, you know, scarf threats and then find scarf rewards, right? Avoid scarf threats, right? Great point to stop and digest and then we'll wrap up. Take a few minutes, talk amongst yourselves and we'll take some questions. Go for it. Talk amongst yourselves. Questions, comments, reflections. Questions, comments, reflections. We're about 5 to 8 minutes off finishing up. Is that all right with everyone? Good? No one's going to freeze. Yeah.
I just missed something on the last thing you said.
Can you start again with, hi, I'm David.
Did you say something like, list of the things that are scarf threads and then list of the things that become rewarding?
Think of a project. Right. Think of a project like something you want to change. Right. So this plays out in every situation. You get into a taxi, you give the driver too many instructions, you get a status threat, they growl at you, you know. Like this is playing out all the time, right? But it particularly plays out when you're trying to change, you know, a person or a process, right? So think of a project you're trying to change, your project or, you know, something or a person, a team, a system, whatever. And you think about when you go to change that system with the current strategy you have, how are you going to affect scarf? Right? Are you going to cause a status threat accidentally in the way you're currently doing it? Right? Are you going to cause an autonomy threat? Are you going to create massive uncertainty? So think about, in a particular way, you usually find there's one domain that's going to be a real problem. So it seems like there's one domain that seems to have the biggest kind of impact. I mean, some things we do impact all five. There's usually one that's the worst. So like if you're, you know, I mean, I work with a lot of corporations and, you know, if they're going to get rid of people's offices and go open plan, which is like one of the worst ideas ever, by the way, you lose a day a week of productivity, people get sicker,
And they save a little bit of money, but they end up spending much more. But what happens is, you know, for individuals, it's sort of affecting all of them, but in particular, it affects status. It sort of affects all of them, but people like losing their sense of status, you know, they've got this space, they feel like they don't belong, and, you know, so it's, but it sort of affects all of them. And then you could say in that case, well, which one of these domains could you get a reward in as you understand them? In that case, it's probably autonomy by giving them some kind of feeling control back. You might balance out the status drop. So it's called the offsetting effect. As you think of the things where you look for what is being sort of affected negatively and see if you can find one or maybe two domains you can affect positively. What could you put in the positive? I'm going to send you a couple of papers. I'm going to send you one. The original paper was published in 2008, and we'll send that to you. And there was an update in 2012 that explains the offsetting effect. And so we'll send those, and you can kind of dig into those if you want, and a few other things. But the idea is, you know, use this as a way, ideally ahead of time, to map out a better change strategy. So you can use this like before, during, or after, like an interaction where you're trying to, you know, change a person or process. And the ideal time is before. You know, map it out. If we're in a workshop doing this, we'd sort of, you know, get you to like pair up and sort of think about that. Look at your project through the SCARF lens and sort of, you know, work that through. Question?
In practicing meditation, which part of that like system is that trying to attack? Is it trying to make the away threat like line big thinner? Or is it trying to make the reward system larger? Or that's more of like a framework question. But.
Yeah, that's a big question. It's a big one to close with. But what I can tell you is there's lots of types of meditation. So if we take, say, traditional mindfulness meditation where you're noticing experiences, sort of labeling them, what you're doing is mostly you're noticing threat responses, you're labeling them and putting them aside, and you are activating a little bit of the braking system and just getting more to a slightly positive. In a mindfulness exercise, you're supposed to be like paying attention in the present to something slightly positive. And so you are trying to attune a little bit to this, but there's something else a little bit deeper that's happening. There's a blog called The Neuroscience of Mindfulness, which I'd encourage you to read if you're interested in that question. It's basically the sort of one of the ideas at the heart of your brain at work, but I put it on a few places. It's in Psychology Today and Huffington and a few places. So if you look at the neuroscience of mindfulness, you'll get a really kind of good explanation of what's really going on. It impacts the direct reward network, but it's not exactly about that. It's more about you're practicing switching between what's called a direct experience network, where your attention is in right in the information, and switching between that and maybe a narrative network, which is more the story. And the narrative network is actually the threat reward network, and a few others. But the narrative network is like the concept of something. The direct experience network is the true data in the moment coming to you. And so if you're a practitioner, what you're doing is you're practicing switching between the story and just being there. The story and just paying attention. And when you are just paying attention, those two networks are anti-correlated. So when you are just in the moment, you know, with data, it actually switches off the whole system, sort of in a big way, neutralizes it. So there's not necessarily a threat or reward. It's more balanced. So that's the biggest story. But I did check out The Neuroscience of Mindfulness and dig into that one there. We should one more and then we'll wrap up. Yeah.
So if we are working towards a goal as a society, and that goal or achieving that goal is actually giving threat in those four areas out of five SCARF, how would we override that? Like, for example, if we're fighting Monsanto, and then Monsanto people do not want to give up because it bothers them status, certainty, autonomy, relatedness. Only thing that left is fairness towards farmers, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, what would be left, you know? And it's an interesting challenge. And, you know, obviously there's people's livelihoods will feel a threat, which, you know, really makes them dig their heels in. I mean, there's some research on this, and I'll answer this from a slightly different angle, but, you know, they're looking at, like, environmental change, for example. Like, telling people all the terrible things will happen if they don't change the, you know, environmental habits doesn't actually do much. What actually does something is tapping into people's desire to look good. Right, people. So telling people what others have done around them, for example, actually seems to change behaviors pretty well. So, you know, your neighbors have collected, you know, 5 pounds of garbage this month. Oh, okay, I'm going to collect 6.
and you actually change behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
So you're tapping into the status issue there as a way to create social change at a sort of micro level, rather than making people feel, you know, rather than trying to raise the threat response. So that's sort of an example of how that plays out. So think about, you know, which of the domains could you get, you know, moving to the positive. Now, if you're trying to, you know, tell people to, you know, stop having a livelihood, you run into some complexity. You're trying to convince Monsanto employees that what they're doing is wrong. It's very hard because, you know, they might have all sorts of livelihoods, you know, wrapped up in that. So, you know, how do you come at that ecosystem another way, you know, rather than going directly at it? And how do you come at it a whole other way? So, you know, going into the threat response is really hard. You know, trying to steer right into the threat response is hard. How do you kind of create a system on the side that, you know, chips away at it? It's often a better way. Think about, you know, Apple didn't try to undo the record business. They just, you know, saw a better way to do things, and it resulted in that. But they just saw a better way to do things. So build the better way to do things. And sort of that's rather than try to attack the system, build a better way to do things. So and positive models is how we learn. Positive models and sort of, you know, wanting to do as well as others, those kinds of things are really important. So a couple of closing comments. Resources. There is literally a Google video, a Google Tech Talk of me talking about everything that's in the book. You can watch that for free on YouTube. You'll see me cover a lot of what I did today, but in a different way, and you can pause it and all that stuff. Which is harder to do here. You've been trying. The book's available, obviously, in every format and all that stuff. The papers I'm going to send you, the SCARF paper, if you're really serious about the research, get a membership for the Institute, the NeuroLeadership Institute. Is there a student membership? There is a student membership. So you can get, and you can access about 65 papers we've written and sort of be part of that network. Neuroleadership.com, you'll see all that there. So there's a research institute there. And DavidRock101 on Twitter, if you want to sort of stay connected. I post maybe 10, 20 times a week, different studies coming out, and sort of, you know, interesting posts and things, you know, around the space. So DavidRock101 on Twitter. Get on the mailing list, you know, neuroleadership.com, if you want to sort of see different events and activities and stuff, you know, happening there. There's a summit happening. I mentioned we present new research. It's in New York this year, and you can watch the whole thing free as well if you want to. The other thing, for those of you interested in this, we are hiring. We're like growing 120% something a year. We've got about 30 something people in the office here in Park Avenue, and we're definitely hiring project managers and designers and writers, and I don't know who else we're hiring. There's way less hiring. Lots of people. So we're hiring tons of people, and we hire, you know, younger people and all sorts of people. So we're hiring lots of different things at the moment. So we'll probably add 10, 20, 30 people in the next year. You know, we love hiring people from New York City. So. That's talk to Latoya if you're interested in that. But just, you know, if you find tonight curious and interesting, just encourage you to just follow the threads, you know, follow what's interesting. I've written a ton of blogs also on Psychology Today. Just look up David Rock Psychology Today. Tons of blogs. In fact, just about the entire book's there in blog posts if you want to sort of dig in. But the SCARF model's there and all the sort of research behind it's all linked. So that's pretty much everything. Just hopefully you've had a fun night, and I've worked up an appetite, and hopefully you'll be more successful as a change agent. Thanks very much.